My feelings started to change when I realized that dancing was getting inside my body emotionally as well as physically, and that it was taking on a whole new dimension, and my life was changing. And I had a performance where I got on stage with an orchestra, and at the dress rehearsal, there was no one in the audience, but I suddenly was in the real atmosphere of a theater, and I looked out at these empty seats, but I felt all this sort of dust or feelings of people who had been there before. It was palpable, and I just thought, this is what I want to be. And I knew that dancing would be my chosen profession. And I never regretted it, never regretted the work, never got over that same feeling. Even now when I go in a theater, it's a very special place to be in. And the work and the responsibility that goes along with it is very special. I'm not afraid of hard work or the responsibility. That's why it was important that I learned to love dance for its own sake, and the feeling that it gave me, the happiness, the security, the release of my feelings, the building up of my insecurities or my feelings, it made me a person. It brought out in me who I had the potential to become. And I think that's why I loved it for its own sake, not to want to be a ballerina. You know, it put a whole different emphasis on the situation. And on the other hand, I think it's wonderful for everyone to take ballet classes at any age. It gives you a discipline, it gives you a place to go. It, as I said, gives you some control in your life. You're with music. You express yourself in a way that frequently words you can't explain to even your best friend. And it's in a beautiful environment. And then, of course, when you get on stage, you can be anything. You're removed from reality in a way, the real world, and yet I think that when you are a performer, and for me a dancer, is when, to me, that is more real. It's not fantasy. It's a certain amount of pretending and your hard work and your training and your professionalism, but it's more real because I've spent my life in the theater and on stage and in the classroom. So far from feeling that it's not the real world, I feel that I see the real world more realistically because I see it clear when I am dancing. I had gone to one audition about a month before because this...
How old was I?
I was 14. And in Kentucky, a company was coming, a Canadian company was coming to perform in Kentucky. And a friend of my mother's knew the woman who ran the company. And we thought that maybe I could go and audition, not to be in the company, but to get a scholarship to the school, because in Cincinnati, Canada was the big time, you know. And I wanted to have more knowledge and more opportunities in dance. So Mother thought this might be good. So I went down there and I auditioned, and I guess I was a failure because they were not impressed. So I was going to retire as a dancer. And then the following month, we read in Dance Magazine that the Ford Foundation had given money to Balanchine, and they had gotten a grant to go out to scout around the country and pick promising students to have either local scholarships at their own school or to come to New York. So we thought this was wonderful. My mother thought this was wonderful. And I decided to come out of my retirement and face this audition. So a very beautiful, I knew she was beautiful because I would go to the library and look at ballet books and pictures, and I was familiar with her as this image, this very, very tall, beautiful image. And the fact that she was tall was important to me because I was very tall, and I had been told in a letter from this other Canadian company that I might be too tall to be a dancer. So I used to sleep curled up in a ball because I read you grew at night and I was afraid that I would be too tall to be a dancer. So when Miss Adams came to the studio to watch a class in which we were auditioning, I was very happy to see that she was very tall. So all those fears disappeared for me. And it was over. I don't know how well I did. She didn't say anything to us. She basically talked to the teacher and took her own notes. But I had a program from when I went to see the New York City Ballet in Indiana a couple months prior to that. And I took it to her and I asked her for her autograph. And she wrote good luck on it. And I thought that she was wishing me good luck, or that she thought I would need it desperately, or I don't know what she meant, but I took it as a very personal message, good luck, and that gave me such inspiration and such trust. So she was the person who eventually suggested that I audition, go to New York and audition for a scholarship. Not that I had one, but the fact that she said good luck was enough for me to hang on to and to consider pursuing my dream. So we went to New York, and of course I did get a scholarship. She was a very wonderful lady, a very elegant person, and I learned a lot from her, not so much in what she said, but in what she didn't say. I think she knows, and you know, in our profession, yes, you learn from people, but it's also important to have your own thoughts. And there were times when I asked her advice, but we didn't become pals, you know, and I didn't learn to have her with every decision-making situation, which I think was good, because sometimes people want to coach too much, they want to impose themselves too much, and you cannot do that in life, or especially in a person who wants to be creative and an individual. So she was wonderful in the fact that she didn't become overly protective or say, I think you should do this or you should dance this way. She also told me what she knew, you know, if it was that when she was teaching class, and made suggestions. And I learned from her also. I think you can get a lot more, make a better impression by suggesting something to someone than telling them what they have to do, because everyone has to assimilate it in their own way. Some people may need 100% of what you said. Some people may only need 5. But whatever they need, it's vital to them to become the whole entity that they have to become. So she was wonderful. That's an easy question. It was, of course, George Balanchine, who came from Russia via Europe and settled in America in 1933. Started a little company, which was not very successful, so he had to start over and over again. And ultimately, he founded the New York City Ballet. And for me, I happened to be born at the right time, came in the right place, and had the fortune to audition for him and work with him, because he is the genius of the century and of ballet. But so of course I learned how to dance from him. I also, I think he was a great philosopher. He had a wonderful theory of that you live in the now, which I think is important. Along with living in the moment, you also have to assume the responsibility that goes along with it, and you don't take your position lightly. But it also means that you get the full value of the moment that you are living, and so you don't look back on your life and say, if only I hadn't wasted time, if only I had done this. You do the best you can. And it was wonderful to be able to go home after performance and say, well, it wasn't maybe so good, but it was the best I could be at that time, you know. And then you have a departure point and some place to go to for the next time. But at least you know you tried your best. And so there's always some kind of progress, and you learn from that situation. So I learned a lot from him aside from just learning how to dance. And of course, he was quite a bit older than I was. He, 49, 50 years older than I was. But so I had the benefit of all his experience, all the ballets he did before I was even born, plus the ballets that he did when we were working together up until he died. So it was like I lived his lifetime in my short career as a dancer. So it was a great experience. But I think you have to respect time very much and know the time you are living in, and that we're all living on this at the same time, but we're all at different times in our life, and you have to see that clearly and make the best of it. I didn't read that much in school because I became a dancer and I didn't have that much time to sit down and read, or the kind of body that would sit still that long. So Mr. Balanchine told me that he wanted to do this ballet, and he had wanted to do it for quite some time and felt that now was the right time. He thought he found the person to do it for. So it was a departure for him and his image that he had, his American ballet image that he had invented and created in America, because it was three acts and it had a story. Most of his ballets were what they say, plotless. There was no story. Well, I should say there was no libretto, because certainly there's a lot of emotions going on stage, but it was a novelty for him to do a big three-act ballet with a big story and lots of scenery. I played Dulcinea, his inspiration, and it was particularly exciting because the first night he did the part of the Don Quixote himself. It was more a character part as opposed to a dancing part. And basically, it brought us together in terms of our future collaboration of working in the future. Up until that point, I still was always in awe of him and couldn't really say much to him other than, how's the weather, you know, how's your cat, something like that. So it really brought us together where our work and our feelings became very important, and it was a great ballet. I had a wonderful time. I played many different parts in it. It was working on a lot of levels. It was the first time a big ballet like that had been built around me. There were very few dancing roles for a company of 60 dancers at the time, so it was basically my ballet, and that, of course, caused some friction from other people in the company because they weren't too excited about something where they didn't figure too prominently. On the other hand, I also had a job. I was paid as a dancer, and this was my work, and he chose me, and living in the moment, I was going to get the best out of it. So we started working. I started to read the book. Couldn't find myself in the book, 1,000-page book, you know. And finally, I went up to him one day in rehearsal. I had the book, and I said, I can't find myself in here, you know, where am I? And he said, no, you don't have to read the book. And so it was the beginning of where I really trusted him. We learned a lot. I believed that anything I needed to know about the ballet would be in his choreography. From a technical point of view, he started looking at me and asking me to do things that he had never asked someone to do before, and it seemed at the time impossible, and yet I realized that it's not impossible, it's just different, and let's work on it. So impossible went out of my vocabulary, and I said, no, I can't do it today, but let me work on it and we'll see. So it became a wonderful working, collaborating situation, laboratory, I like to say, because we were always trying and failing, or trying and discovering. And when someone believes in you and you believe in them, I very much believe in people and trust. And I think it's a very empowering thing to give to someone and responsibility to have in return. And there's just no end to how hard someone's willing to work when you have their belief in you. It's where technique doesn't really play as big a part as how you look at the picture, the part that you play in the picture, you know. So I learned a lot from that ballet. I also learned how to dance. The early days of my career, getting back, I was always this young, virginal girl in white, you know, and I liked that. But again, I guess it was part of the tomboy in me where I'd always want to be a little contrary, you know, so I used to wish that I could play maybe the black swan instead of the white swan, or the evil girl, you know, instead of the good girl. And so when I came back to the company, this was the first thing Mr. Balanchine did for me, and I was curious to know how he would see me. And so Zigan means gypsy, it's Hungarian. And I was healthy, and I thought, oh, I'm going to, and at the height of my dancing possibilities, and I thought he'd give me something very technical, but the first thing he had me do was sort of mosey on stage in this rather indifferent quality. And I thought, oh, this is very strange. I'm not sure if I want to look like this. You know, how are people going to think? You know, they expect me to dance. And then I said, no, he's always presented you very well, and you believe in him, and you know, let's try something that hasn't been done before. So we started working on this ballet, and it was a lot of fun to be a gypsy. But the night of the premiere, well, and by then Mr. Balanchine and I had become comfortable with each other, and frequently he would say, oh, you know what I want, you fill in, you do that. And that was very nice of him, but also a big responsibility, because it had to look like what he might do, be in the same flavor and the same character as what he might do. And wonderful that he trusted me enough to say, oh, Susie, you know, you do it. So it was quite thrilling, and gave me a lot of freedom in a world that has a lot of discipline. So at one part in the choreography, he said, oh, just stand here and do something and then start turning. Well, the ballet starts out, I'm dancing to a solo violin. There's not even a conductor, and I don't even see the violinist. He's down in the pit. There's just a single spotlight on my face, and the rest of the stage is dark, so it's very, very lonely. In fact, it's probably the loneliest I've ever been, even lonelier than walking down a street in New York by yourself. To be in front of people, have to look interesting, have to go from one side of the stage to the other, portray something, but you don't have even a sound, you know, an orchestra to fill the void. So it was just this one lonely violin and myself, and I start to dance. And it stays this way for about 5 minutes. It was a long solo. And just before the ballet changes, and I'm supposed to do this slight step and pantomime and then turn like a whirlwind before my partner was to come in, the violinist got carried away and he started playing extra music, and I didn't know what to do. So I reached into my bag of tricks and I put my hand out and I pretended that I was a fortune teller and writing down a fortune on the palm of my hand. And that's become the choreography. And now people would look for that in the ballet, but that was not choreographed. That happened at the moment when I had extra music left over and I didn't know what to do. Couldn't just stand there and not do anything, you know. So I said, well, I'm going to write my fortune, you know. And that's what I did. And then by then it was time to do the next part of the ballet. But it's remained in the ballet and become one of the signatures of that particular ballet. But that was a lot of fun. He, of course, was my teacher. He was my friend. We were, I believe, also in destiny. I think that we were meant to be together. That we both had chosen these professions. He from Russia, me from Cincinnati. It's so strange that our worlds should, our orbits should intersect, you know. And we both wanted to work in ballet, you know. So we became very close. We were very much in love with each other in many ways. And I think that if it hadn't been that way, we wouldn't have gone on to do the work that we did. We were both very professional, but and he could work with other people, and I could work with other people, but it was important in the whole scheme of things that we have this great love for each other. And it was devastating at times, but I tell you, I wouldn't trade it for the world. I wouldn't change any of my life. I'd live it all over again the same way. I've had injuries, but again, I'd always get out on stage because I think the body is a wonderful thing and you have to treat it with respect. We don't work, and we haven't even as human beings reached our potential for what we can do, you know. I went through a period where I had hip trouble. And I thought it was just a typical pulled muscle, and I did all my stuff, you know, liniment, and warmed up a little more than I thought was necessary, or all the things that we learn to do when you have a typically dance-related injury or sore muscle. And over the weeks, the months, it didn't go away. In fact, it got worse. So eventually, I realized that I had a very serious problem, and it was the first time that I couldn't, that dance suddenly seemed to let me down. You know, what had been my salvation and my security was, my body was abandoning me, and this was emotionally and physically devastating. And it took me a long time to admit that I had arthritis and that it was not going to ever get better. But strangely enough, when I got on stage, I had no pain, because the moment when I was out there was so important, and the now of the situation was the only thing that mattered, that my body rallied somehow. And we have these powers within us, you know, endorphins. You know, the body can do amazing things in a situation when it's really called upon. And so I remained dancing and performing so that I didn't have the pain, even though the same movements in the classroom would be painful. Somehow in a performance situation it was not. So I went several years in that situation. And I was happy, because by then I was told that I'd have to have an operation. And of course, you don't dance with an artificial hip. So I knew that it was important to me to stay dancing as long as possible, so that, because I knew once I had the operation, I would not be able to dance again. So it kept me, and I was happy. I had to curtail and alter my repertoire. I couldn't do everything that I used to, but I was dancing and I was happy. So there are really times, and then there were emotional times. I've been, you know, I tell my students, you have to learn to dance even when you don't feel like it, because most of the time you might not feel like it. And so but the amazing thing is that when you start to dance, everything seems wonderful and puts it in perspective. By the time I admitted that I needed a hip operation, which was the hardest thing, I had denied it for so long that It was a breakthrough to suddenly say, I need this. And I knew that I would probably never dance again, but I had no choice because by that time, I just wanted to be normal. I wanted to walk down the street without limping. I couldn't tie my shoes. I couldn't, you know, put slacks on. I really was the farthest thing from a person who ever could dance and do all those extremely incredible extensions and contortions that we do. So, but I had no choice, and so I had the operation. And I was very happy when I went in, and happy when I came out, because suddenly I saw that my life, I would live my life instead of watch it go by, which it was the way it had become lately in that situation. And so, of course, the doctor said I would never dance again, but I wanted to. But I didn't think about dancing again. I just thought about getting well. I put all my energies into the moment that I was now living in, and that was getting well. So, and I thought, if God wanted me to dance, he'll let me dance. Finally, it got to the point where I got back on my feet and I was walking, and people were curious as to know what was going to happen to me now. And I was giving a little speech, which was the first time I publicly admitted what had happened to me. And the reason why I was speaking was because I was a dancer, and now I was speaking as a person who may never dance again. So it was one of the hardest things that I ever had to do, was to be in this situation where I suddenly didn't have any real control or any of the stability or security that I had always as a dancer. And but I had just recently gotten off crutches, and I was determined to walk up to this platform and give this speech in high heels, even if I was slightly listing to one side, and tell these people about what it was like to be a dancer and what it was like to be a dancer who couldn't dance anymore. And I remember I started to cry because, first of all, I wanted to make my point. I could be admired as a dancer, but I also wanted to be admired as a person. And I said to them that I had to work very hard to become a dancer, but now I had to work even harder to get back any little thing just to be able to walk, and let alone dance. But that I wasn't embarrassed by that, that there will be things, if I dance again, there will be things I cannot do, and even if I don't dance again, there will be things I can't do to the extent that I used to. But that it didn't really matter, that I would be the best that I could be with what I had, and that if I didn't dance, that I hoped that I would have the conviction and the moral commitment and the courage to let go of something that I couldn't do any longer, and to do the best that I could do with what I had. And I think that was very important for me to say. And it works, you know, sometimes when you just, and I tell my students, the act of thinking about something is almost doing it. If you think positively that you can do it, you're already closer than if you didn't even try to do it, because we're that sophisticated. And I think it was a big step for me. And consequently, I did get back on stage. I did dance again, in a different capacity and not with the range of motion that I had, but I got back on stage, not to prove a point, not to be some sort of oddity or hero, but because I wanted to quit myself. I had felt that I sort of had the rug pulled out from underneath me by my hip, and that I also knew that I would be better if I had a goal to reach. If I didn't care really whether I ever got out on stage again. I only knew that I had to try. That I would be unhappy. I would be unhappy if I didn't try, but I would not be unhappy if I tried and failed. And so that was my impetus to get out on stage again and to dance again. I was very much of a tomboy, so dancing was not something I had a great desire to do. In fact, ballet companies didn't exist in the Midwest when I was a child. One would come to town maybe once a year. So I think it's rather strange that I got into ballet, something that I hadn't seen. But what was my motivation was music and the fact that I love to move around. I'm always moving around. And I think it was important that I learned to love to dance eventually for its own sake, as opposed to wanting to be a ballerina, because I think it made me realize that there was a lot of hard work involved before you get to be a ballerina. And I never lost loving the actual work that was involved in it. So, but then, of course, I got on stage, and I decided then I wanted to be a dancer. I had two sisters, and we would love to get dressed up and pretend that we were chic, sophisticated ladies. And I think that was a great sort of preparation, in a way, rather theatrical, and something that was a lot of fun to do. And in a way, it translated into getting on stage, where you dress up and you become someone other than who you are. And we used to put on little shows in the basement for the neighborhood people. And of course, no one would come who would want to see what we had to offer. But we took them very seriously, and we gave these performances. Coming from the Midwest, I had a great background. I think we had a big backyard. There were trees. I was always climbing them. There were lots of opportunities to go to sports events and things like that. I had a wonderful childhood coming from Cincinnati, and I think that it was great going into the life that I was going to have, where you have to start young as a dancer, and you don't have the opportunity to really lead a normal life like most young teenagers do. And so I was very happy that I was as normal as possible before I went into to dance, seriously dance. My mother was very interested in giving her daughters the advantage of music and dance if we had an interest in it. My father was not. He thought it was really unnecessary. It cost money, which we didn't have. And ballet in America still was quite a young profession and a novelty. There weren't companies in every city like there are now. And I suppose it proved to him not to be a very practical adventure and didn't require a formal education, and he was adamantly against it. So it was a great controversy, and so there was no support there. And eventually my parents divorced, and I was happy. I was grateful that I had dancing to fall back on. It was my survival tactic. It was my friend. It was always there. And the fact that I could work out not necessarily my problems, but a lot of my emotions by going to class and dancing, I never felt lonely. And I'm grateful that I had ballet to get me through those days. And in fact, even when I became famous, it was a great, great friend to have. It's a wonderful thing to be able to dance, to tell your body what you want it to do, your leg to go up, and it goes. Not without a lot of hard work in the beginning, but the fact that you tell yourself what you want to do is a wonderful form of security to me, I think, especially in a world where you have so little say about what goes on in your life or in the politics of the worlds around you. It's wonderful to go into that studio and tell yourself what to do, and you respond, and it works. School was fun. I loved tests because it was another form of competing, I guess, a healthy competition. I liked to have to think on the spot. I never worried too much about whether I would pass or not. I liked math. Counting was easy for me, which was good because a lot of the ballets have involved counts. I liked spelling. I like anything that has a big problem to solve. History was not too interesting to me. And I liked to read, but being a dancer, I didn't have a lot of time to read. Well, of course, in the art class, I was the model. I had long, stringy hair, and they knew I was a dancer, and they thought that was wonderful to have this profile with this long ponytail. So I feel that I am personally responsible for all these artists learning how to draw a ponytail. And Latin. I liked Latin. I liked languages. I liked all the myths and the Roman tales that were required to translate in Latin. All these interesting people that were never quite what they thought they would be or seemed to be. It was very theatrical and very, I think, imaginative, and worked very well for the type of world that I went into. My first class started because my two older sisters were in, one in dance and one in piano, and we lived about an hour away from town where the conservatory was, and my mother had to take me along in the car. So I would always be fidgeting, you know, while my sisters were having their lesson, and the ballet teacher came up and said to my mother that you really should have your daughter enrolled in some of these classes. It might give her some poise and help her to sit still and make your life easier. So I started dance, and you had acrobatic and ballet and tap, and I much preferred acrobatics, being an extension of my tomboyishness. And I liked tap because I liked hearing the results of my movements. And I didn't care too much for ballet because you had to be more disciplined and you sort of looked like everyone else, and it required a certain kind of conformity that I didn't feel like I wanted to do. And so it didn't interest me until steps got more involved and I began to get it into my body, and I saw that this indeed had quite a bit of self-expression. It was not as uniform as I thought it was, and I started organizing my own little ballet company, and I was the boss because I was the tallest. But along with that went responsibility. I had to make ballets for the girls that were going to be in my company, and lots of times, frequently, in the early days of my dancing, I was very tall as a young girl. And there were no boys in the ballet school, so whenever the recital would come along, I was always the prince, never the princess. So I think that's one reason also why I wasn't too crazy about ballet in the beginning, because I never got those pretty tutus. But of course, all that changed. Well, it was quite simply the only thing my mother and my sister and I wanted to do at that time in our lives was to come to New York and further our training. And we got here, and we were, of course, typical tourists, saw everything, did everything. And I had a wonderful childhood in Cincinnati, but my mother had realized that if we wanted to further our training and become better or professional, we'd have to go to New York. So fortunately, she was willing to come. She was more than happy to come. My sister was a very talented pianist, and so we came to New York and lived in a tiny one-room apartment, but we were happy because we really lived at the piano or in the dance studio. And I think my work gave me a flexibility that I would not have had, even though it's very channeled and you have to be committed and work very hard and eliminate some things in your life. It also gives you a flexibility because you have to admit what's important in your life at that time. And it doesn't mean that it has to last forever. To me, forever is as long as it lasts that you're still productive and you're still at the best you can be. And I think that was important, and it wasn't important whether I became famous. I just wanted to be the best that I could be. And so you're always in competition with yourself and not someone else. She, of course, was very much Mr. Balanchine's idea at that time of what he wanted his female dancers to look like, and she was very good with the Stravinsky ballets, the long line, and she had beautiful long legs, and Mr. Balanchine had started working on a Stravinsky ballet called Movements for Piano and Orchestra, and she and Jacques d'Amboise were to have the leads. It was a small ballet. This music had never been played in America before. It was very atonal, very even Stravinsky to people who knew Stravinsky. And she became pregnant. And she had always wanted a child and had never been successful in having a full-term baby. So this was very special to her, and she told Balanchine that her doctor had advised her not to dance, not to even move. So Balanchine lost all interest in the ballet, and the premiere was next week. Stravinsky was coming over from Germany. He was going to attend the premiere. It had already been advertised in the papers. It was a very big disaster that this had happened. So Jacques and I had done a few lecture demonstrations together for different churches and things, and he knew that I could learn quickly and that I would get out there and try my best, regardless of what the outcome was. So he suggested to Balanchine that Suzanne learn it. Mr. Balanchine was not very interested, but finally Jacques coaxed him into allowing him to take me over to Diana's. So we went over there, and she taught me literally while she was reclining on the chaise. And of course, it was a small living room. There was no recording of the music at that time. You couldn't dance on the parquet floor, so I was just in my bare feet around, you know, with her coffee table moved to the side, and she was telling me things, and he was telling me things, all to no music and just to counts or things like that. So it was the most bizarre way. It was the vaguest way of learning something that would be so physical. And on the other hand, I learned something. And we showed it to Mr. Balanchine the next day, and he, I guess, thought it was close enough or interesting enough that maybe we wouldn't have to cancel. He wouldn't have to cancel the premiere, and he would work from there. So he started to work, and eventually things came together, and I did the ballet, and it was great fun and great success. But I think I am the only person who knows that ballet, having learned it under the circumstances that I did. But it was a great opportunity for me, and it was the beginning of many ballets, many roles of hers that I would eventually go on to learn. But quite a strange situation. Well, I was still trying to finish high school, which was always a problem between my mother and I. She wanted me to finish high school. I wanted to do what she wanted also, because I still didn't know that I would have this great career in ballet, and it's important to get your education. It's important. Education should be throughout your whole life, but she wanted me to have that diploma. And finally, I started learning more roles, and I just, you know, went to her one evening and cried, and I said, "Mother, I just can't do it," you know. So by that time, maybe she thought that I might have a career as a dancer. But anyway, this particular time, I was coming from having an exam at my school and had a rehearsal, so I was a little late to rehearsal, and I thought that I would get, you know, I would just have to apologize because I had to take this exam. But I walked into the studio, and there was very much this kind of setup, a film crew from Germany, lights, cables all over the place, Stravinsky sitting in the center of the studio, Balanchine, Kirstein, all these people, you know. And here I was late, and they were all waiting for me while I was devastated. So the rehearsal didn't go very well, although no one except Jacques and I knew the choreography. But anyway, I was embarrassed that I had been so inadequate. And after it was over, I went up to Mr. Balanchine. We still were only speaking about the weather at this point. And I said, you know, I don't think you should let me do this ballet. I'm just not ready for it. And that was not a terribly sensible thing for someone to say, given this great opportunity. I mean, I could have, you know, really talked myself out of having this wonderful situation. But I felt that I was not ready, that I just wasn't good enough, especially since there were so many other better dancers than I was. And he said to me, he clasped his hands like this, and he said, dear, you let me be the judge. And I thought to myself then, well, if he believes in me that much, then I'll let him be the judge, and I'll, to the exclusion of everyone else. And so it was the beginning of a great understanding, which is something you have to have in a creative situation. And it made me realize that if he thought I could do it, then I won't let him down. No, I never, strangely enough, being such a tomboy and being so, what my mother said, spoiled when I was a child, once I started dancing and in a way growing up, I was not the spoiled brat or the rebellious child that I was when I really had no reason to as a child, you know. Because when you work, it's a laboratory. Even if you're in the studio, the dance studio, when we were working together, it's the place where you experiment. And you don't have to be, I'm not intimidated by failure or making a mistake, because you learn from those situations. You don't learn from a situation where you do something well. You enjoy it and you give yourself credit, but you don't really learn from that. You learn from trial and error all the time. And you never know when you fail, if you have, maybe you failed in that particular instance, but you've discovered something else. A lot of the ballets that we went on to do were built around mistakes that we had made in the classroom. So you never sort of throw anything out. And rebelling takes up energy. And as a dancer, you don't have that kind of energy to throw away. So I'm not an argumentative person. I'd rather use that temperament to be productive. That's different from being temperamental. You have to have temperament, because it's part of emotion, and ballets require every emotion you can have, can feel, to get your point across, or to move differently. When you're happy, you move different than when you're sad, you know? When you smile, you're different than when you cry, you know? And that's why it's important to keep yourself in a good frame of mind, so that you can be open to all these options that might come your way. And, I mean, to me, getting out on stage is like true confessions, you know? If you look like you don't want to be there, if you feel like you don't want to be there, you look like you don't want to be there. And no matter how professional you are, you can masquerade that for a time, but people feel what you are feeling eventually. And it becomes very apparent. But I think temperamental is not good. But you have to have temperament. Also, it was interesting to me because no matter how brilliant you were the night before, how many keys to cities you get, whatever happens to you, and that's all very nice to be accepted and to be appreciated, because we want to entertain, we want to make people happy. You go the next morning and you take class and you start out and do exactly what the babies do. You know, to me it's very humbling, and it puts things in a real great perspective that you go back and you start out exactly like the young first-year students do. And then, of course, your class changes and you build. But I just thought it was a wonderful paradox that, and it brought you back to your roots. And so you had always a fresh departure point. You weren't staying in a situation that had already occurred. You were starting a new life every morning when you went to class. And that's very invigorating and sobering. And you can allow it to be to teach you, or you can let it threaten you. Different people handle it in different ways. I decided that I would let what happened to me teach me instead of traumatize me. And that's all wonderful, and it's great to meet people now at this point in my life, because when you're on stage, you don't see faces. The lights are in your eyes, and you see just this black void out in front of you. And yet you know there is life out there, and you have to get your message across, and hopefully they are sending a message back. And it's a wonderful feeling, but I enjoy meeting people at this point in my life. But no, I never expected all these things to happen to me. And I don't know where my life went. You know, suddenly, I still feel like a 15-year-old girl coming to New York. Dancing does that to you. I think it keeps you really young. I like to get up early in the morning and maybe read, because it's the only time I have to be me before I become the dancer part of me. And sometimes I would go to the theater and sit in my dressing room and put my shoes on that I would be dancing in, so that my feet, which had maybe gotten big overnight, could get a little more small, so that when I went into the studio, I could put on my point shoes and start out in a learning situation and be the best I can be from the moment I start out, so that you don't use half of class to wake up, you know, have your coffee and wake up. So I would go to class every morning. I liked that. It was also wonderful in the sense that you didn't wake up and say, gee, what am I going to do today? I don't have anything planned. I don't know what I want to do with my life. What am I going to do? To me, there was no decision. I knew that I would go to the theater, see my friends, but most important, I would work and be happy in that. So it was great to know that I had a place to go every morning. I always went to class. Again, I liked the work that went into dancing. It was, and people have to realize that there's a lot of fun. It seems very glamorous, and that's true. It is. It's wonderful. To me, it's like no other profession in the world. But there's constant work all your life before you even can get out on stage, and If you only live for the performances, you'll never learn how to dance. And also, you have to make your body respond even when it doesn't want to. Some mornings you'd wake up and you'd say, oh boy, I really don't feel like going to class. I don't want to dance. I mean, I got depressed. I didn't always want to dance every day of my life. But somehow I knew that I had to get myself to the theater to study, to take class, because I think better when I'm in the environment that I've spent most of my life. And I always thought better when I was working, thought clearer when I was working. And so no matter how much I didn't want to go to the theater when I seemingly woke up in the morning, I always said, well, go and see how you feel. And usually by the time I'd start moving around and dancing, I'd feel good. And some of the mornings that I felt the worst were the days that I'd have the best performances. So you just never know what the day has in store for you. So you always have to be optimistic and say, go and see what happens, you know, or live this moment as it comes, you know. There's pain and sacrifice in everyone's world. That's why, to me, dancing sort of When I was dancing, I had no pain. You know, you have the choice of looking at the donut or the hole in the donut, you know, and I chose to, you know, devour the donut. It's a way of how you look at things. And to get to the more technical part of that question, yes, there are injuries, but there are injuries in everything. Yes, I got depressed, but you work yourself out of that. And when I look back, I have to think about what was depressing, and I have to really put my mind to work and think about what was painful, because I don't really remember it. It's not the uppermost thing in my mind. It's not the way my scale of happiness is balanced, you know. It's just not that important. Well, I guess everyone deals with it a little differently, and I started getting parts when I was quite young, and so I got criticized when I was quite young. And naturally, everyone wants to be liked, and people can have an opinion, but somehow when it's written in a newspaper or a magazine and it's right there for everyone to read if they read it, it's a little different than it was if it was just verbal and, you know, you can dismiss it. In the beginning, always, you know, I got sort of good reviews, and then occasionally something was not so nice. And those are the ones I saved because I found them interesting. But again, I was lucky to have Mr. Balanchine, and I went to him. And since I respected him and I thought he was the best, I trusted him. And I put my trust in him as a choreographer, as a person who would not put me out there if I looked bad, because that would be a reflection on him, and he wants the best, you know. So I decided that I would trust him and listen to him only. And it kept me from having to account to other people. Everyone's entitled to their opinion, but if you ask 10 people, you get 10 different opinions. So I decided just to trust Mr. Balanchine. And then, of course, his standards were very high, and they became my standards. And so, you know, I just sort of said, well, I thought it was good, I did my best, or this wasn't so good, I have to work more on that. And it keeps you really from going crazy. And also, I'm a performer, and I don't believe you can be an honest performer and a spectator at the same time. So you have to choose who you choose to listen to very carefully, because it takes different eyes to be a spectator. I'm used to looking out of my eyes, and in that sense, now that I don't dance so much, I have to reverse the way I look at things. So my whole sense of criticizing in the sense of evaluating a situation is different. But I think critics have to respect the feelings of a person as much as the facts, and report them with responsibility. Yes, I know they existed, and I by nature am a shy person. I guess it's partly from my background and coming to New York, and it was just my mother and my sister and I, and we didn't have money to go to movies and, you know, socialize, so I was very isolated. And some of that, most of that by choice, because dancing is, in a way, a solo, and you don't need someone to improve in your own dancing. And again, that was something that was wonderful. You can do it all by yourself. You don't need a room full of people to tell you, yes, that was good, or no, that wasn't good, or let's do this. It's something that you have to be in command of all by yourself. So I by nature am a singular person. But of course, when I wanted friends, I didn't have too many friends because I was put into this position where I started getting all these roles. And of course, I could understand their envy. I probably would have felt the same way if the shoe was on the other foot. But Balanchine ran his company the way he wanted to, and that was his choice. But at the time when I was dancing, in the early stages of my career, there was a lot of competition. There were a lot of good girls around, and we all were dancing, and it was a wonderful time to be a dancer. I think that takes away a lot of energy to be wishing you were doing something else. Even people ask me what my favorite ballet is. I don't have a favorite one. I would always say it's the one I'm doing at that moment, because it's ungrateful to be wishing you were doing something else at the moment that you're living. Otherwise, you never live. You haven't lived in the moment that you're really living. You were wishing you were somewhere else. So I always handle that question. It's the one I'm doing at the moment. By going and working. See, how do we know what our ability is until we get in there and work? Just like, you know, scientists. How many times they've blown laboratories up many times before they've made a great discovery, and we have to do that. And that's what's exciting in life, is that you have options. There are some dancers who like to rehearse, and people, I guess, do this in life. They rehearse their life, they rehearse their office attitude, they rehearse how they're going to live. And that's sad to me. I always rehearse differently because, again, the moment is different. Maybe come time to do this ballet, you're going to be very unhappy. And so that will affect you. Yes, you get out there and you smile, but your feelings internally are different. Or maybe the music will be played too fast or too slow. In a way, you can never, the wonderful thing about life is that you can't, there will always be variables, and you have to see them and be aware of them to know how to react to them. Otherwise, you're living every day the same. And I think, so when I would rehearse, it differently each time. Maybe it would be awful, but it would be an option. So that when I got out on stage, if the dictates of the moment required it, I had what I call my bag of tricks that I had been through. And you just store them up for the time when they will come in handy. And otherwise, you're rehearsing an opinion. If you do it the same way all the time, if you rehearse the ballet the same way all the time, if you write the same essay, you know, you draw the same little ponytail, you do everything the same, you're rehearsing an opinion, and before you know it, you can't change. So I think you have to see everything that's going on around you and take that into consideration. It also kept me from getting bored with my work. You know, ballet is interesting. You have to start young, you have to work hard, and yet every minute you're working to get better, you're using up your body, your instrument, which you want to preserve so you can dance longer. It's not even as if you have a violin and you put it in a case and it stays good for 100 years because it's made out of expensive wood. You know, your body is the thing you have to live with. You go shopping, you walk your dog, you do everything. And it's vulnerable to everything that's going on, and so you have to really, you want to work as quickly, not in speed, but in honesty and in assimilating what is necessary. You want to work as fast as possible so you don't have to over-rehearse and thereby use up the instrument that you want to keep in as good a health as possible so you can dance longer. You understand what I'm saying? Yes, I always, the moment I'm on this side before I go out, I have these feelings of insecurity. There's what am I going to do? Even though I'm professional and I know what the steps are, I don't quite know how I'm going to do them because I haven't lived that moment yet. And I always feel very insecure and I get very excited. Nervous, but not so that I can't dance, but excited with nerves because I love to do what I'm doing. But I always had reservations, you know. I just didn't quite know what I was going to do. But the minute I got out there, and there's no turning back, you realize that you're more in control than you thought you were because there is no turning back. It's when we always think we can turn back that we don't make good decisions or we don't try hard enough. It's when you jump off the cliff that you're suddenly in control in a way that you don't have prior to that. And so to me, I never knew quite what I would do when I got out there, but when I got out there, I was in control as time was going on. And people think that you get out there and you become this person, you know, if it's a particular part, Dulcinea or a gypsy, or you become someone else, and that the whole rest of the world doesn't exist, it's oblivious to you, but that's not true. Yes, you don't see a lot of things that are going on around here, but you very much know what's happening in this world that you are in. And you have to be. You can't get lost in this dream world because I've had situations happen where my partner's forgotten to come in to catch me, you know. So you have to think on the spot. I've fallen down on stage. And believe me, you don't know how fast you can move, how quick you can think, and how smart you can become until you're in a situation where you've fallen and people are looking at you. Or that's what I mean. You learn from these mistakes, these situations where that aren't perfect. But those are the ones that you learn from and you learn how to handle them. And so, funnily enough, some of these things that have happened on stage translate into my life, especially now that I don't dance anymore. If I can handle something like that in front of people looking at you, then I feel I can handle anything. Maybe not right away. Maybe I don't know how, but I know I can, and that's very good. It was tougher when I saw it coming because I abandoned my philosophy and I didn't live as fully in the now because I saw my now that I loved so much coming to an end. So I was, you know, I was really terrifically unhappy and devastated that I couldn't dance forever because I never got tired of my work. I never got bored with it. I never lost the commitment. I never didn't want to dance. And I don't know where all that time went to, but I saw it coming to a close, and I was really, I didn't know what I was going to do. I was lost. And strangely enough, on my last performance, it was so easy because it was the last and my life would go on. I would still wake up. I would still be a dancer. I wouldn't be dancing anymore, but I will always be a dancer. So in a way, it hadn't really changed. But I hear music and I, you know, wish I could dance. But I had the opportunity to go to Russia and to stage, you know, to teach them a ballet of Balanchine's. And it was good to have something like this to fall back on, something that I had to suddenly learn 19 parts instead of only one part. I was responsible for the men and the women, and I don't speak Russian. I was going to a country where, you know, it's very strange. And but for me, it was exciting to do this in my profession, but it was also going to be my acid test, whether I would survive as a non-dancing person. And would I be able to tell them everything I learned? Would I be open enough to give away all my secrets or open to them my bag of tricks? You know, just how generous would I be in a situation where I couldn't do it anymore? So I went, and I was so happy because I learned things that I never would have learned if I had physically been dancing them. I find people wonderful, you know. We learn to communicate by our energy, by our eyes. I could feel in the beginning they didn't want to accept a foreigner coming over and telling them something that they thought they did better. It was the closest thing to an audition that I had ever been to in my life. At this stage of my life, I had to, you know, sort of audition now that I don't dance anymore. And yet, it all worked out so wonderfully. I told them, eventually I got an interpreter, and I told them that I trust them. I told them exactly what had changed me as a dancer, that somebody believed in me. And over the course of the days, you know, they learned the ballet, and it was not without its incidents and its lack of organization and all the things that go on with being in a country like Russia and trying to get some organization. But I tell you, come time for the performance, I sat out front. I was excited for them in the same way that I got excited when I would dance, but I didn't want to be up there. And I was just as happy being out there watching. I was happy for them to have this responsibility and this opportunity. And I was, so I not only taught them a ballet, but I also taught myself that I can survive, that I can be happy not dancing, you know. And I enjoy doing that. I find people want to be happy and they want to work. And they will almost do anything for you if you say, I believe you. I find that when I say I trust you, that's gotten me farther than 100 classes or any kind of formal training at all. So that was very rewarding, and I enjoy doing that. And the more you teach, the more you learn. I say that what you are is you. I said to them, no one has your eyes, no one has your face. That's so uniquely yourself that you have to try to find to be the best you can be and the clearest picture of who you are. You should never want to be someone else. You can learn from me, as we all do. That is what passing it on is. That is what I feel we call tradition. But if you have nothing now, tradition is made in the present, because if it's not, how would all those people that will go on to live, have anything to take from us? So you have to make it in the present, and you have to be who you really are, and you're so uniquely yourself. Everyone dances, everyone has two legs, they go up, everyone turns. You know, we all know our profession, we know our craft. You go to school, we all can do something, but no one can do it like you do, so you have to find yourself and be the best you can be, which has infinite possibilities. Working. I'm a worker, the more I'm doing, the better I am. The less I do, the less you want to do. So I have to find ways to fill my life that are as fulfilling in another way as they were as a dancer. So I have to satisfy my physical capacity as well as my emotional capacity in a way it's like starting over again. I feel I've done it again, but now I'm doing it again because I like to teach and I'm happy doing that. As I said, I find people fascinating and no two people are alike. And I like finding, you see, I have to find their problems so that I can teach them. You don't just teach somebody how to dance. You have to find out what's they can dance or they can't, but you have to find out what their dilemma is or create their problem so that you can teach for them so they can become better. And so you have sort of like a problem on top of a problem. I enjoy staging ballets. I love the theater, so I even wouldn't mind trying some drama. I don't know. I'm open to suggestions. I'm sure the next 40 years of my life will be as exciting as the last 40, but they're not as clear right now as when I was a dancer. But I don't know. Anything can happen. I believe in mystery and miracles, and I just know I have to be working. This is a black papier-mâché cat. His name is Mr. Lucky. I named him Mr. Lucky in 1960. My best friend, my blood sister, you know, when you, in Cincinnati, we pricked our fingers and we mixed our blood and we were sealed for life, this friendship, you know. Well, she made this cat for me before I came to New York and auditioned. And it was a cute little black cat with ears. Anyway, this was my good luck piece, my talisman, and so he's been with me all over the world, always on my dressing table. He's lost both ears. He's has not much of a face, but he's always been there with me. And then I have, of course, other cats. It started out like that because Balanchine liked cats. He had what he thought was the most famous, talented cat that could jump. And I was doing Titania in A Midsummer Night's Dream, and it's where Shakespeare, where she falls asleep and then wakes up in this dream, and she's in love with this donkey, this weaver who has been transformed by magic fairyland Oberon into a donkey. And she wakes up and she loves him, and his name is Bottom. And as I said, I was only 17, 18, and I didn't have quite the right quality that Mr. Balanchine wanted for this pas de deux. I mean, how many people dance with a donkey, you know? So he said, at the end of rehearsal, he said, "Don't you have an animal at home that you talk to or someone that you love and play with?" And I said, "No, Mr. Balanchine," you know? So he said, "Oh, that's too bad. I have a wonderful little cat, and he's a great jumper, and they're very interesting." So I went home that evening with my school books and stopped at the delicatessen. And, you know, every New York delicatessen has a cat, at least one cat. And this cat had kittens, so I asked the owner if I could have one, buy one. He said, "No, you can have one." So I took one, and I brought her home and named her Bottom and started practicing on this cat the quality that he wanted for this pas de deux. So that was the beginning of my cats, and at one time I had about 10 cats, but she was my best friend. We grew up together. She was the person I confided in when I didn't have, you know, any friends in the company, or so next to God, this cat knew more about me than anybody, and she was really wonderful. When she thought I was on the right track, she'd sit there and purr and listen to me, and when she thought I was wrong, she'd go, she'd spank me. So she was very, very human. I think far from ballet eating into your life and not allowing you to have a life, I think it's given me a better quality of life. It's helped me to be much more balanced, I think, than I would have been without it. I don't feel that things you've given up are things that you, also it's a choice. You probably wouldn't have wanted them anyway. I'm consumed with my work. Not, it doesn't consume me. It fills me with, you know, a great feeling of who I am and what I want to do. I don't feel that. I think there's a timing for everything. I think you can have everything in life that you want, but not all at the same time.